Well, good morning and welcome to our Good Friday service. Of course, this is a two-parter. You must come back on Sunday to celebrate with us. But today we're going to try and capture some of the mood and some of the feel, even over a video of that day, as Jesus gave his life for ours. We'll be doing that in the normal ways, through some reflective readings, through some songs, through words of confession, and as Ben opens up and shares to us some thoughts from the passage. As we begin, let me just say a prayer of introduction, and then we'll head to our first hymn, O Sacred Head, Sore Wounded. Lord, for many of us, this day is so significant, as each year we reflect on the one who would give up his life for ours. We recognise there was no one else good enough who could pay that price for us, but Jesus alone, willing to go through. Lord, help us to use today as a reflection. Help us to not jump so quickly to Sunday, but to pause at least for a few moments to reflect on the magnitude of what Jesus has done for us. In his name we ask. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, it's right for us often when we meet to reflect and be aware that we have not lived perfectly, but especially on this day. So I've got some words that might just help you and I to reflect on the significance of what Jesus went through and our own failure within that. Have a listen to these words, and you might want to say a hearty amen at the end. Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have failed you, as did your first disciples. We ask for your mercy and your help. When we look to our own comforts rather than to you, Lord, we ask your forgiveness. When we act as though we're stretching out in peace, yet nurse enmity and bitterness in our hearts, Lord, we ask that you would forgive us. When we strike and speak out at those who hurt us, rather than seek to bless, Lord, forgive us. When we deny that we know you for fear of rejection of the world and its scorn, Lord, forgive us. Well, to those who come to Jesus, who recognize their own need for a Savior to be forgiven, hear the words early on in John's Gospel. Yet to those who did believe him, who received him, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of a natural descent nor a husband's decision, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. It's good news this morning to those that would receive Jesus. We can only sing the truths that we love to rejoice in week by week, because Good Friday, truly in history, time and space, really did happen. So I hope this rest of this morning helps you to reflect upon that day. As we hear from Ben later, as we reflect Old Testament, New Testament, as we see in the words of our songs, the true cost that Jesus took up. And you won't see me again, I won't come back at the end of the service, but just to warmly invite you now to come with us Sunday morning, come and rejoice and celebrate. But for now, let's use this time to reflect and to remember.
Psalm 31. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me. Come quickly to my rescue. Be my rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. Since you are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of your name, lead and guide me. Keep me free from the trap that is set for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hands I commit my spirit. Deliver me, Lord, my faithful God. I hate those who cling to worthless idols. As for me, I trust in the Lord. I will be glad and rejoice in your love, for you saw my affliction and knew the anguish of my soul. You have not given me into the hands of the enemy, but have set my feet in a spacious place. Be merciful to me, Lord, for I am in distress. My eyes grow weak with sorrow, my soul and body with grief. My life is consumed by anguish, and my years by groaning. My strength fails because of my affliction, and my bones grow weak. Because of all my enemies, I am the utter contempt of all my neighbours, and an object of dread to my closest friends. And those who see me on the street flee from me. I am forgotten as though I were dead. I have become like broken pottery, for I hear many whispering, terror on every side. They conspire against me and plot to take my life. But I trust in you, Lord. I say, you are my God. My times are in your hands. Deliver me from the hands of my enemies, from those who pursue me. Let your face shine on your servant. Save me in your unfailing love. Let me not be put to shame, Lord, for I have cried out to you. But let the wicked be put to shame and be silent in the realm of the dead. Let their lying lips be silenced. For with pride and contempt, they speak arrogantly against the righteous. How abundant are the good things that you have stored up for all those who fear you, that you bestow in the sight of all. On those who take refuge in you, in the shelter of your presence, you hide them from all human intrigues. You keep them safe in your dwelling from accusing tongues. Praise be to the Lord, for he showed me the wonders of his love when I was in a city under siege. In my alarm, I said, I am cut off from your sight. Yet you heard my cry for mercy when I called you for help. Love the Lord, all his faithful people. The Lord preserves those who are true to him, but the proud he pays back in full. Be strong and take heart, all you who hope in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
To see the King of heaven fall in anguish to his knees, the light and life of all the world now overwhelmed with grief. What nameless horrors must he see to cry out in the garden, or take this cup away from me, yet not my will but yours, yet not my will but yours. To know each friend will fall away and heaven's voice be still, for hell to have its vengeful day upon Golgotha's hill. No words describe the Saviour's plight, to be by God forsaken, till wrath and love are satisfied and every sin is paid, and every sin is paid. What took him to this wretched place? What kept him on this road? His love for Adam's cursed race, for every broken soul. No sin too slight to overlook, no crime too great to carry, or mingled in this poisoned cup, and yet he drank it all. The Saviour
Luke chapter 23, verses 44 to 49. It was about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon, for the sun stopped shining. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, "Surely this was a righteous man." When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. But all those who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, you might want to keep open Psalm 31. If you have more than one finger, you could perhaps keep a finger in Luke as well. But Psalm 31 perhaps would be the best if you have to choose. One of the most exciting things about lockdown in the Lucas household has been getting guinea pigs. I don't know if you have pets, but this was quite a thing for me to say yes to a pet. So I finally said yes to some guinea pigs. When we first got them, of course they run around and you want them to acclimatise to their environment, don't you? So you put them in their cage and you don't play with them so much the first few days, worried that they're going to run away. Well, the funny thing is now, if you take them out of their cage and you put them slap bang in the middle of the kitchen floor, even though there are all sorts of exciting places that a guinea pig might hide in our house, what do? They run straight back and jump into that cage. They jump for the cage. They just absolutely love it. In fact, on more than one occasion, I've come down in the morning to find that the girls have not shut the gates, the doors of the cage, and there they are, sitting in the straw quite happily. They wouldn't leave it for a million carats. See, for them, the cage is a familiar place. It's a comfortable place. It's a place of safety and warmth, a place of refuge when they're frightened. And we're not so different to guinea pigs in some ways. We all have bolt holes, comfortable places we go to when we're nervous or frightened. In fact, these needn't be places. Especially as we grow older, perhaps they are people. They can be activities as well. And we've seen this, haven't we, this year? So much more even than ever, perhaps, taking refuge in places we didn't even know were refuges. What have you missed during lockdown, I wonder? Particularly when you've felt low. We've all felt low at points, if not for the whole of this year. What support have you particularly deeply missed? You missed family gatherings. You missed lunches with friends. You just missed the encouragement of singing in church. Have you missed cake? Well, maybe you've taken refuge in cake as a special lockdown activity. Many of us have. It may be that you didn't even realise before lockdown that these were places of refuge for you. Well, look, today we see that there is a refuge, an ever-present bolt hole, an ever-present place of help. And we see an incredible example of the circumstances in which we can turn to this refuge. Turn to this comfort. You see, before Jesus died, Luke records that he quoted the words of Psalm 31 that we read earlier, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." And in quoting these words of a psalm which is a song of an innocent person, Jesus alludes to the whole thing. He calls us to remember the whole of the psalm as he would have done and as his people would have done. Jesus cries out to distress. Our champion cries out. And he commits himself into God's hands. He'd grown up with the psalms. He read them. He memorized them as a child. For him, as they can be for us, they became a way to express his situation. And it reminds us that Jesus really entered the human experience.
experience. He really became like us. And so we too can sing these songs. We too can trust in the same God, knowing that Jesus has experienced the depths of all it means to be human. So today we're going to consider briefly the last minutes of Jesus' life through the lens of this psalm, which Jesus quotes. The first thing we notice is that Jesus commits himself into the Father's hands amidst reproach. Look with me in Psalm 31, verse 11. The psalmist shares this with God. I am the utter contempt of my neighbors. Have you ever felt like that? Have you ever felt like the world is completely against you? As Jesus prays this psalm, we know how true this was for him, don't we? Jesus, who'd been led to the cross, Jesus, who'd been delivered up to death at the hand of an occupying force. And all this from his neighbors, his own people. Look at the next line of Psalm 31:11. I am an object of dread to my closest friends. Those who see me on the street flee from me. An object of dread to my closest friends? What a terrible fate that is. The distancing of friends is a terrible fate, isn't it? Worse, perhaps, even than the reproach of our enemies. And this is precisely what happened to Jesus. In Luke 23:49, we read, all those who knew him, including the women who had followed from Galilee, stood at a distance. Now, when you go to a sports match in normal times, you turn up with your team's shirt on, don't you? You wear your football team's shirt. You sit in the stands, and as you sit in the stands, you're surrounded by people wearing the same shirt, wearing the same woolly hat, the same scarf, all supporting the same team, rooting for the same thing. And even though thousands are stood opposite wearing a different colour, you can still boldly sit there surrounded by your friends, can't you? Boldly stand saying, we want to win, down with the other side. But you can only do that because you're surrounded by thousands on your side. If they all left the stands and you were by yourself before thousands opposing you, the situation would be quite different, wouldn't it? We're just at the moment of death. Jesus not only experienced the reproach of the Romans, not only aggression from his own people, he was abandoned by his friends, even his most faithful friends. The mention of the women is there for this very purpose. For Jesus' women followers were his most devoted followers, some of his most faithful friends, yet even they, having come along all the way from Galilee, even they stood at a distance. There was none to encourage him. There was none to support him. There was none for him to join in with. On the cross, as he died, Jesus was utterly alone. So this, the hardest reproach of all, Jesus endured for us. He endured it for me. He endured it for you. If ever you felt abandoned, if ever you've been left in the cold by those closest to you, here is assurance that Jesus, the one who stands at the Father's side, praying on your behalf, understands. He understands how that feels. You can open yourself to him, knowing that he is one who understands. Well, the second thing we notice really follows obviously on from Jesus committing himself amidst this reproach, because it's obvious then that Jesus commits himself into the Father's hands before deliverance. Before the deliverance of God, this song is sung. In Psalm 31, again we read, in you, O Lord, I have taken refuge. I have taken refuge. We could read this perhaps as though it were in the past, as if the psalmist was saying something like, Something bad happened and I took refuge in you. But that's not what's going on, is it, actually? Later in the verse we read, deliver me in your righteousness. That is, Lord, I'm in the midst of trouble. In the midst of trouble, so deliver me now, O Lord. This cry to God to be delivered shows us that the psalm is not sung after the event, but amidst the event, before any deliverance has even taken place. So again, as Jesus hung on the cross, as he died the slow, agonizing death of crucifixion, he speaks his trust in God. They say hindsight is 20/20, don't they? And that's so often true. When Emily and I were first married, we wrote up a budget. I had a friend who insisted I write a budget with a spreadsheet. He was that sort of a spreadsheet sort of a guy. And we put all the essentials into the spreadsheet. We put our rent, we put our food, we put our heating. And it was such a successful spreadsheet that there was even money left over unaccounted for. There was money for spending. We had every single month £2 unaccounted for in our newly married status. £2, what riches we had. Needless to say, it was looking pretty tight when we first got married. Well, a few months after we were married, our car broke. Well, this looked really bad, of course. After all, there was not really much chance of replacing a car on that £2 a month excess, was there? So we couldn't really get a new car, but we very soon realised, actually, that it was a real blessing. It was a real blessing because we couldn't really afford a car anyway. And in fact, we lived near the station, and with hindsight, we could see that it was a good thing the car broke. Much harder at the time to rejoice at that. But look, it's similar in the Christian life. Much easier, isn't it, to say later, oh, God brought me through this. I see God's hand in that. I see where he works. Much harder to see, to learn to trace God's hand in our present trials. Not just after the fact. In our present trials. And this, of course, is exactly what Jesus does. And he displays peace. This is peace. This is what Christian peace is about. Notice what he's displaying, peace. He's displaying peace as he dies on a cross. But look, true Christian peace is not found only in a secluded garden on a lovely midsummer's evening. The peace the Bible talks about is peace in the midst of children screaming, in the midst of medical uncertainty, in the midst of a financial crisis, whatever it might be. This is the promise of the gospel, peace in the situation, in the trial. My friends, don't settle for anything less than this full-orbed peace in the midst of trials. So we've seen that Jesus is amidst reproach and the loss of his friends. He commits his life into God's hands amidst trials. And the final thing is, of course, that he commits his hands himself into God's hands, not necessarily even the outcome we might expect. Certainly we might not expect it, even if Jesus did. And not the outcome he wanted. We know that from Gethsemane. Take this cup from me, he cried. But it will be the best outcome. God's outcome will be the best outcome. Look, Psalm 31:24 again declares this. Love the Lord, all his faithful people. The Lord preserves those who are true to him. Remember, this is the psalm that Jesus is singing on the cross. And it ends with this, that resonates round. The Lord preserves those who are faithful to him. Just put yourself in Jesus' shoes for a moment. He'd been welcomed into the city which soon turned on him. He'd been turned on by his own people. Delivered into the hands of enemies. He'd been beaten, he'd been mocked, he'd been spat on, and finally abandoned by his closest friends. And in this moment, darkness covers the land. Jesus chose this psalm. This psalm, knowing full well the psalm ended this way, knowing full well that the promise of the Lord was to preserve those who trust in him, who are true to him. How can this be true? How was Jesus, the innocent sufferer, preserved? We, of course, know the end of the story, don't we? We know that on Easter he is risen. We know that he was not preserved from death, but that he was preserved through death. And this is powerful for us to take in. For God walks with his people through the valley of the shadow of death. He walks with his people in the fire. The preservation that the Lord brings to those who are true to him is so much more than a physical protection in the here and the now. It's much more than that, much, much more than that. More than immediate healing. It's more than just provision of a job. It's so much more. The preservation offered by God through the cross is the preservation through death and life on the other side. It's the destruction of death itself. We see this in Jesus' life. This may not be the outcome he wanted. We may not be the outcome we want, but our commitment is to God who knows and wants and will bring what's best to us. Death is at an end. John Donne wrote, "Death, be not proud, though some have called thee mighty and strong, for thou art not so. And those whom thou think'st thou dost overthrow, die not, nor canst thou kill me." On the cross, we see the end of death itself. Death loses its sting. So we stand before it and we can declare, "Death, where is your sting? You think you overthrow those people? You don't, and you cannot overthrow me. I will walk through death, for I have seen my Saviour die. I've seen him rise on the other side, where we will be like him." Have you taken to heart the depths of the Lord's preservation? The depths offered here? We can get so distracted, can't we, by the things immediately around us. Distracted so that we fail to see the big picture. Don't allow yourself to be drawn to things close to hand in this life, wanting God to fix immediate problems. Fix your eyes on the most glorious preservation. Preservation through death. Through death to eternal life. Where is your safe space? Let's not settle. Let's not settle for anything less than God. God the Father. For he is the one refuge who cannot be overwhelmed. The one refuge who cannot be taken away. The one refuge that delivers through death and leads to life everlasting. Jesus had been delivered into the hands of men. And it led to his being mocked, beaten and killed. The reversal here is that peace comes. Peace comes, of course, as he leaves the hands of men in his death and is entrusted into the hands of God. So let's examine our lives to ask whether we have turned to God in times of need or whether we've looked elsewhere. Giving an honest account of our hearts, let's ask God to draw near. Ask God to draw us near to him in our times of need. God really, really is our refuge. He's our refuge even when trouble comes, not only from where we expect it, from the distancing of enemies and those we may expect it from, but when it comes from our very friends, our very support. And God really is the refuge before the deliverance occurs. The psalm is sung not in retrospect, but in prospect. Finally, brothers and sisters, we have a good Father who loves us and is our refuge through death. So take this psalm, take Psalm 31, and pray with Jesus, your brother, committing yourselves into God's hands to the one who delivers even through death. Amen.
Sinful man.
its maker bows his head and is torn in two.
Let's come to God together in prayer. Let us pray. I'd like to use some of the words from Psalm 31 for our prayers. David writes, "In you, Lord, I have taken refuge, my rock and my fortress." Thank you, Father, that we may come to you in prayer and echo the words of the psalmist David. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge, my rock and my fortress. And in verse 9, David goes on to say, "My eyes grow weak with sorrow, my soul and body with grief." Father God, there are times when we are in sorrow. It might be for those near to us, for our nation, perhaps for the world and all its troubles, even for ourselves, Lord, in our sadness. Thank you that we can bring our sorrows and sadnesses to you. But nothing compares to your Son, the Lord Jesus, Man of Sorrows. What a name for the Son of God who came ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah. What a saviour. The psalmist goes on, "My strength fails because of my afflictions and my bones grow weak." Lord, we thank you that, like David, we can come to your throne room in heaven and bring you our prayers and concerns of our struggles, our afflictions and our weaknesses. And like the psalmist, we can call out to you with these words, "My faithful God, my times are in your hands. I trust in you, Lord. I say, you are my God." Thank you, Lord, for the encouragement that this psalm brings to us. When David says, "How abundant are the good things that you have stored up for those who fear you." Lord, we want to ask your forgiveness that often following our prayers, we forget to return to give you thanks for answered prayer, for the abundance of good things that you give to us. As we have prayed for many things in the past, Lord, we thank you indeed for your abundant love and care for each one of us, for answering our prayers and walking with us. Father, as we look to the cross and remember the Lord Jesus and his dying words, into your hands I commit my spirit, Lord, my faithful God. Another song goes, I sometimes think about the cross and shut my eyes and try to see the cruel nails and crown of thorns and Jesus crucified for me. Father God, as we look out on another week, as we look forward, we thank you, Father, that again we can use the words of the psalmist. Praise be to the Lord, for he has showed me the wonders of his love. And again, be strong and take heart, all who hope in the Lord. Thank you, Father, that we can put our hope and our trust in you, our living and loving God. So we bring you our prayers in the mighty name of Jesus, as we say together, Amen. Amen.
When I survey my soul, my life.